chapter 1, verses 30 through 33, and listen what the Word of God has to say. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He'll be very great, and he'll be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he'll reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." In 1952, a famous swimmer by the name of Forrest Chadwick attempted to swim from an island to the California coast. It was 50 kilometers away. Now, long-distance swimming was not new to Florence Chadwick. She was the first woman to swim the English Channel in both directions. However, on this day, the water was cold. There also was a dense fog. The fog was so thick that she could hardly see the safety boat in front of her. She swam for around 15 hours before she asked to be taken out of the water. However, when she got on the boat, she discovered she was only 1 kilometer from shore. She had already swam 49 kilometers. When asked about this event, here's what she had to say, and I'm quoting it. "I'm not excusing myself, but if I could have seen the land, I might have made it." In other words, it wasn't the cold. It wasn't even her exhaustion that caused her to give up. It was the fog. She could not see the shore. She felt there was no hope of reaching land, and so she gave up. Now, just so you'll know for the record, that 2 months later, she tried the same swim again, the same channel, the same distance, minus the fog, and she did it in record time. I discovered that people give up when they cannot see a solution to their problem, when it seems that there's so much fog in their mind, so much clouds in the air, when there's no light at the end of the tunnel, which is an expression we often use, or there seems to be no end to their constant pain. In other words, if I can just kind of boil it all down, people give up when they cannot see hope. The world, my friends, the world which you and I are a part of, is longing for hope. Everywhere, people are searching for hope. They want peace. They want a better life. But the problem also is they're looking in all the wrong places to try to find it. So who really can give us the hope that we long for? Well, for us sitting in this room, for most of us, I would say, we understand that real hope, everlasting hope, only rests in knowing Jesus Christ. It's in Him alone that we find our redemption and our salvation. The angel's proclamation to Mary was a very hopeful proclamation. And not just to Mary and Joseph, it was hope for all of Israel. It was what they were waiting for. And if you're not aware of it, this hope was promised 7 centuries before it actually came true in Mary and Joseph's life. It was promised by the prophet Isaiah, who wrote in Isaiah 9, 6 through 7, "For to us is born a child, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he'll be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He'll reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." In other words, when Jesus was born, God made it clear that this baby indeed was the one for whom the world had been waiting, watching and hoping ever since the first man and woman were kicked out of the Garden of Eden. This was indeed the Savior, the Deliverer, the King. What joy must have filled the hearts of Mary and Joseph as they looked down at this tiny son, wrapped in blankets, lying in an ordinary manger filled with straw, surrounded by cows, sheep, and donkeys. What hope in knowing that this child is the one in whom all of God's promises would be fulfilled? Knowing that he was the one in whom God's people would find the forgiveness for their sins. The one in whom they would find true and lasting peace. The one whose power would establish an eternal kingdom of justice and of righteousness. It must have been almost overwhelming. I could not imagine being in that situation. Because not only is this the promise of God, now there comes responsibilities in raising God's child, which lay on the shoulders of Mary and Joseph. You know, I mentioned these things because I want you to know that Christianity is a religion of hope. In fact, you really take that word religion out. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ which provides our hope. It's a faith that looks forward to the future, to the time when God's promises will be fulfilled. That was true for God's people prior to the Lord's birth. They were waiting for this moment for the Messiah to come. It was true for Mary and Joseph as they looked down at their newborn son, knowing that it is true, this child brings the fulfillment of God's promise. His name will be called Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. But it's also true for you and I that are sitting here today as we look forward to the second coming of Jesus Christ. So you see, our faith is a future-focused faith. It is one that is based on hope, looking forward to what is to come. Now, that doesn't mean that Christianity has no relevance in our daily lives right now. Far from it. The Christian faith, my friends, is intensely practical. But it means that the here and now is not our primary focus. It's not our only focus. Our focus is on the world to come. Notice what Paul writes in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Since then you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. But here's a discovery. Even though our focus is on the world to come, funny thing, it's our future focus that allows us to live this life to the fullest. It's because we know of God's promises that we can get through every day. Now, that would be a good conclusion to the message, wouldn't it? Some of you are already shaking your head, wow, what time is it? This has been a quick Sunday. But there's a problem. Hope is not automatic. In fact, sometimes hope is very difficult. Have you had difficult seasons in your life that hope came very hard to come by? Yeah, a lot of hands are going up. It may be life situations, it may be health situations, it may be relational situations, financial situations, but there have been always seasons in our lives where things come upon us, and they come upon us in such a degree that it looks hopeless. So how do we sustain hope in the midst of sometimes disappointments? How do we sustain hope in our times of difficulty? How do we keep ourselves from becoming overwhelmed by trials and pain? Because they're going to come. That's just a part of life. How do we maintain an attitude of hope when everything in us wants to yield to despair? When we can't see a way out, when we simply just want to throw the towel in and surrender, what do? Well, what I'm about to say is going to sound like a cliche. Way too simple, oversimplified is what you may be thinking, but it's really the only answer Scripture gives us. Put your hope in God. Now, the reason I say this is because many will say, well, Pastor, you know what? That comes from many sermons, that's come over time. I just don't know what you're talking about. Well, let me ask, when you're going through difficulty, what do you do first? Are you seeking the counsel of somebody else? Or are you turning to anything other than God? Does he become the appeal of the last resort? after we exhausted every other option, is it then that we finally go to God? So if our problem is financial, do we actually go to God first and ask Him for wisdom and direction? Or do we go to our banker? Or try to find out if we have a rich relative in our ancestry anywhere to give a call to see if he or she can help us out? Or do we rack our brains wondering, how can I get my hands on some extra cash? If the problem is relational, a conflict with a spouse or a family member, do we go out and buy books on marriage? Scholar magazines for other articles on relationships? Do we listen to Oprah and Rosie, hoping they can give us some help in this area? Or do we turn to God for help? When we try everything we can think of, and then if nothing works, if everything else fails, if we get to the end of the rope, as the expression goes, then we pray? If that's the case, we're doing it all backwards. Completely backwards. We should go to God first, not last. The songwriter wrote this in Psalm 42:5, and he's really speaking about his own conflict. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Wow, that speaks to all of us, doesn't it? We've been there. Then he also speaks to himself. You know, you need to put your hope in God, for I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God. The songwriter talks about his condition, his problem, his struggle, the war, and then he goes on to say, you know what? It's always going to be this way. There's not going to be any relief unless I trust God with my life. Unless I put it completely into His hands. Now, I'm not saying that if you are sick, you don't go see the doctor. I'm not saying if you have financial needs that you don't go see a banker. I'm not saying if you have conflict in your marriage and you don't seek out a spiritual counselor that can help you. What I'm saying is if you put your confidence in those alone, you're missing the mark. You need to allow God to speak into your heart, and He may give you wisdom where to go and how to handle your situation. He may use a doctor. He may use a banker. He may use a counselor. He may even use your pastor. It's happened a time or two. But your hope is not in them. It's always in Him. Remember, it's not the size of your wallet. It's not the skill of your doctor. It's not the insight of any counselor that matters. What matters the very most is where you're placing your trust and hope. It needs to be in God and in Him alone. So put your trust, your hope in God. But the second thought I want you to know is Christmas actually is God's gift of hope to us. Amazing. I came across the poem. I have no idea who wrote it. I liked it. I thought I'd share it with you. It goes like this. A very short poem. Christmas is more than a present or two, some eggnog at dinner, choirs singing on cue. For Christmas is God's tune hummed forth in a son, who was laid in a manger, hope's story begun. Come, hum that sweet song then, it's written for you. God's hope in a cradle, it's simple and true. Now, I believe, and I could be mistaken because I don't know the author, but I believe that what the author is trying to say is that the story of Christmas is that God has not given up on us. Amen? Amen. In the Garden of Eden, God talked with us. He walked with us. On the ark, God protected us. In the temple, God sanctified us. In the lion's den, God intervened for us. In the fiery furnace, God stood with us. In the preaching of the prophets, God sought to redeem, to rescue, and to revive us. And in the incarnation, which is the Christmas story itself, God gave the message that He still believes in us. He has not given up. Indeed, He has such hope for us that He actually came to this earth as one of us. Does that ever bother your mind at all? That the Creator of the universe, the one who made all things, made something out of nothing, the one who brooded over the waters and formed the animal kingdom, and formed the vegetable kingdom, who actually molded humanity and breathed life into him, became one of us. This, my friend, is our hope, our reason to rejoice. Let me share, as we get ready to wrap up, a story that happened in the life of my wife and I back in 1983. We were pastoring in a small town not too far from here, just outside of Ogdensburg, New York. And it happened a week before Christmas. It wasn't a Sunday, but it was a day that would represent today. I had come home from the office to get lunch, and I saw my wife sitting by the television set, and there she was just glued to what was taking place. Tears were running down her cheek. For you see, she was watching the new news when all of a sudden a special bulletin broke through. An interruption came about. At that point, the details were still sketchy, but the report was of a 5-year-old boy who had been severely beaten on his way to school and left in a snowbank for dead. Now, the incident happened in a town that was 20 miles outside of where we were pastoring. So it really caught my attention. It wasn't Albany, it wasn't Schenectady, it wasn't Syracuse, it was right here in this area. And those responsible for this horrible act of violence were two boys, ages 8 and 11. They stripped the 5-year-old of his clothes, beat him with sticks and other objects, and then threw him in a snowbank to die. When they were asked by why they would do such a thing, their response was, and I quote, "For the sport of it." Bring it, for the sport of it. The child was so badly beaten that motorists that were passing by actually thought it was a child in a red snowsuit playing in the snow. They did not realize that the red was his own blood. Now, when that information was unfolding, I can't tell you the emotions that was running through my own heart, and my wife's as well. We both sat there crying together, not believing what we were hearing. But what added to it is that we had a young girl, our firstborn, who soon was going to turn 5, and her school is walking distance away. And I could not even imagine how I would respond as a parent if someone took my 5-year-old daughter, stripped her of her clothes, beat her to death, and threw her in a snowbank. It's almost unfathomable, unconscionable. But as I was sitting there, all of a sudden my heart was drawn to Isaiah 53, verses 1 through 7. You might want to write it down and read it later today, because it talks about what we did to Jesus Christ. And as I was thinking of that, recognizing here it is, Christmas time once again, we're going to be singing beautiful carols, which we already did this morning. We're going to praise God for his love, the love he lavished on us through his son, Jesus Christ, which he has done. We'll express during this time of year our love for one another by giving each other Christmas gifts. All these are good. But have we ever paused to understand the fullness of Christmas and what it meant to God? On that first Christmas morning, while the angels were celebrating and the earth seemed to be rejoicing, I myself can picture God with a tear in his eye, knowing that Christmas is only the beginning of things to come. Soon there's going to be a news bulletin breaking through saying, "We interrupt this story." And scanning over time, God could see what Christmas would hold. From a crown composed of thorns to the ruthless cries, "Crucify him, crucify him." As the world heard the cry of a newborn baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, God himself could hear the heavy panting as his son stumbles along the road to Golgotha, near the weight of a crude and rugged cross. As the heavens were filled with angelic choir, God could hear another sound well off key as the hammer pounds out a steady rap upon those wooden nails and an angry mob mocks the heavenly Savior. So during this Advent season, we've talked about peace and joy, and today, hope. Our hearts, I trust, are filled with all these things that God provides, these promises that come from Him. And I do ask that in your heart, you are singing peace on earth, goodwill towards men, and you're doing your part to make that actually happen. But let's not be mistaken about Christmas or its cost. For you see, the world did strip Christ of his clothes, and they beat him practically to death and left him to die. So Christmas is the ushering in of all God's conditional love. It is his gift of hope, knowing that it cost him everything. I hope you grasp that. As the praise team comes back to the platform at this time, I want you to consider the words of the songwriter, which we are going to sing here in a few moments. The stanza says, "The hopes and fears of all the years are met indeed tonight." I hope you understand what the songwriter is saying. For you and I that found Jesus Christ, that is hope. But for those that have treated Christ with mockery and disdain, there is fear that enters their heart. So stand with me if you can. The altar is opened. If God's been speaking to your heart in any way, even through this entire series of Advent-ually, we welcome you to come and do business with the Lord.